So I'm really, really excited for this next presentation. I know you've met Luke Stowe throughout the last 3 days, and Luke, I'm going to embarrass as well, because I'm afraid he's going to be leaving after the presentation, and I have a little tchotchke for you and when you're done. But Luke has been so instrumental in the back end of the conference, with all the help with social media, the agenda with me, the app, and I just, prior to that, Luke is a digital services manager now. Before that, he was our webmaster, and so he loves 311. And so when he got there, I think we became instant friends, and we have worked together on 311. Even though that wasn't his main focus, he always made sure that we were up to date, and without Luke's back end and support, we would not be where we're at with that as well. So I just want to acknowledge you, Luke, for all your help and back end with everything that you've done. So thank you. So with no further delay, I will introduce Luke Stowe from the city of Evanston.
All right, good morning. How do I sound? Pretty good?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Sorry I wasn't able to join you last night for the Cubs game. I guess they lost two games yesterday because it was a doubleheader. That was the first time this whole season they've lost back-to-back games, which I think is a record for the Cubs. So so sorry about that, and sorry about the weather. The weather has been a little goofy, even by Chicago standards, I'd say. Thank you to Sue for the great introduction. I appreciate that. Sue has always been awesome to work with, as you all know. She's always thinking outside the box and willing to take chances and innovate, and maybe something works, maybe it does, maybe it works, maybe it doesn't work. And also the 311 staff that's here from Evanston, they're awesome too. They're so knowledgeable. One thing that's interesting is, and I don't know if you've experienced this in your communities, and I also work for Lake County government, so I've got both county and city experience. We're embarking on a whole new city website. We're gonna be launching that hopefully by the end of this year. We just contracted with a vendor this week, and we're really excited about that project. But I really wanna make 301, the 301 team, instrumental over the next, I'm not gonna wait till the end and that, hey, we have a new city website, here you go, 301. I want 301 to be a part of that process as we build this new website, because who knows the city website better than 301? Probably no one, right? They know the good, the bad, and the ugly, and all that. So, especially from an information architecture standpoint, I'm really looking forward to working with Sue and her team on that going forward. So, if you don't have a seat at the table when your city or county is thinking about doing a new website, I would force yourselves at that table. So, so here's a little bit about what we're going to cover today. I want to talk a little bit about the social media landscape. It's not going to be like Facebook 101 or Twitter 101. I mean, we could spend hours doing that. I assume that some of you have at least some familiarity with the platforms already, you know, especially some of the more established ones, maybe not some of the more emerging ones like Snapchat, but we'll get into that a little bit. If you have questions or concerns about training or the Facebook 101 type stuff, please reach out to me afterwards. And I'd be happy to connect you with free and paid resources. There's lots of good ones out there. We'll talk about a little bit about that. And then also we'll get into a messaging and SMS, which is just on fire right now, as Elias has kind of pointed out in over the course of this conference. And then bots. We're really excited. We're gonna talk a little bit about what the heck is a bot, right? And this is, what is it? It's probably only been like 6 months now that this term has really been on fire. Bots have actually been around forever. For a long time, but they didn't have this moniker, if you will. So we're going to talk about what exactly is a bot. We're going to have some examples. Elias has done some work with Washington, D.C. on a bot that they're just about to launch. And then we're really excited. We've partnered with OneReach to be able to offer you a 30-day free trial to build your own bot and take that home with you. If you have a laptop with you today, that's great. If you don't, that's okay. You'll be able to follow along with Elias, and you'll have a 30-day free trial for your city, or county, or jurisdiction, and you'll be able to take that back with you today. And you can follow along as he builds one, and when you get back, you can build your own, and if you like it, you can experiment with it, you can continue. And so we're really excited about that. So that'll be pretty cutting-edge stuff. And then hopefully we'll have a little bit of time at the end for some Q&A. Conversation is obviously welcome. This is a smaller group. I always learn from the audience too, so you guys all might be doing something interesting or cutting edge. Please feel free to offer that, or if you have questions as we go along, feel free to interject. I think that's it. So let's, I just want to make a quick statement about, I've been to a lot of conferences, done a lot of speaking engagements and so forth, and I've had a lot of associations that I've been a part of in different capacities. And I just want to say that this is a really terrific group of folks. It is kind of like a family, and I think Evanston is a better place now that you've all been here. So. So this was kind of fun. Some of you are probably familiar with this already. The White House Correspondents' Dinner happens every April. I think they've been doing it for over 100 years now. And it's a little bit of humor, roasting, and so on and so forth. But it was pretty cool. A couple weeks ago, the keynote, or the MC, if you will, Larry Wilmore, I guess his parents are from Evanston. They happen to be at the White House Correspondents' Dinner. So the president actually made a remark about Evanston, that it's a great town. And so it was kind of fun. This is just an example of, I actually happened to be listening to it. I had no idea that Evanston was going to get mentioned, and I thought it was pretty cool. And I went on C-SPAN real quick and just caught a little 30-second clip as they mentioned Evanston, and we shared it on Facebook, and it got 425 likes or something like that. It was shared almost 100 times, and it reached 30,000 people. And it literally took me just a few minutes. I passed it off to Patrick on our community engagement team. He shared it, and off and running it was. So it's just a great example of sometimes social is just literally just a few minutes. I mean, obviously we got a break by the president mentioning Evanston, and sometimes that's going to happen in your community where something fun or interesting or a national figure spotlights your community in a good way, and it can take off and go viral, and it just takes a few minutes of work. So anyway, that's a great example. I also want to mention Chattanooga just because I'm a kind of a tech geek and digital geek. Chattanooga is really kind of on fire, so I'm really excited that the conference is going to be there next year. It's the first 10 gigabit city in the Western Hemisphere, something crazy like that, to offer all residents and businesses. So it's really interesting. A lot of startups are moving to Chattanooga. Gary Vaynerchuk, who's the famous social media guy, he owns VaynerMedia, which is arguably the most cutting edge, hottest advertising firm in the country right now. They have offices in London, LA, New York, and now Chattanooga. So that is really a testament to the things that are happening in Chattanooga with the startup scene, technology, gigabit, hackathons. Yeah.
It's amazing what's going on.
Yeah, it really is amazing. So that's really cool that the conference is going to be there next year. So soon maybe I can figure out a way to hitchhike to Chattanooga. So. Yeah, that's right. That's right. I'll be in the trunk or something, but maybe I can get a sponsor. But
we'll work on that.
Thank you. Okay, just let's talk a little bit about social media. Sometimes you hear about like, oh, Facebook is dying, or Facebook is this, or Facebook's not growing anymore. Well, part of the reason for that is these are four-year charts here of the major social platforms. And part of the reason is Facebook was so ubiquitous that it was inevitable that it was going to kind of plateau. As you'll see, the penetration of Facebook is just phenomenal compared to some of the other social platforms. And you know these are five of the six biggest platforms. And even Facebook, it was inevitable that they were going to finally slow down. So you can see almost three out of four adults that are online have Facebook accounts. So I remain, even sometimes you'll see these articles of why I'm quitting Facebook and so on and so forth. And I get that. I appreciate that. But I still think that Facebook remains the biggest elephant in the room, or whatever term you want to use. And it can't be, I think you can't deny it. And especially if you're talking about targeting audiences or advertising or whatnot, it's absolutely phenomenal. The company remains on fire. They just posted their quarterly earnings. It was something crazy, like $1 billion a quarter or something now. So keep in mind too, they also own WhatsApp, which we'll talk about in a little bit, and Instagram as well. So they have this whole ecosystem. So however you feel about Facebook, it still remains very potent. We're going to talk about the other platforms as well. I just wanted to show you some of the growth and some of the penetration on those platforms. Facebook Messenger has really grown tremendously, and I really like what they've done in the last several months as far as customer service tools. And the ability to communicate with residents. Facebook Messenger used to be very simplistic and kind of focused on peer-to-peer or person-to-person, and now they've kind of ramped up these business tools. So I don't know, is there anyone here that is using Facebook Messenger yet, kind of from a 311 or customer service perspective, at least a couple folks? If you aren't already, I would strongly suggest it. And this goes for the entire discussion today, but I realize some of you are directly involved, but we had some great conversations in the roundtable yesterday. Some of you are directly involved in social media and you're actively coordinating. In other cases, you're maybe partnering with someone else or another department, like a communications department or PIO and others. So I realize what I'm hoping that you all get out of this session is kind of a good overview of where we're at with social media and messaging that you can apply to your team, or you can go back to your communications person or PIO or director of comms or whatever the person is and say, hey, how come we're not doing this? Or maybe you should consider this and be an advocate. Because I think the more that you all do with social media as an agency, I think it's ultimately gonna make your jobs easier. Audrey, I think, made a great point, a couple of great points, but I think almost one third of your contacts are being serviced before they even get to your customer service reps. Do I have that correct? It's a huge amount that are being channel shifted. And I think by being proactive on social media, we can also reduce phone calls and emails and so forth.
When you talk about using Facebook messaging for the interaction in the interactive part, we do that. I pushed for that and I still believe in it, but there's definitely some lessons I've learned just in the past few months that I'll be glad to share later with y'all. There's things you need to think about.
Sure. And also, I think I have it on the next slide, they have some new tools. I'll go ahead and jump to the next one. These are fairly new tools or settings. So if you're a page admin, if you're not a page admin, maybe you can ask to be a page admin already. But you can go into settings and you can actually change some of these things. So for example, response time. Response time is really helpful because it kind of sets the expectations. I think you can choose from a few minutes to an hour to a few hours to like 24 hours or a day. And I think that's really important. Sometimes customers have a little bit unrealistic expectations that they're gonna message you on Facebook and you're gonna respond within 5 minutes. And we all know that that's not always possible. Many of us are jacks of all trades and we're bouncing between different things. We might be in a meeting for 4 hours, whatever the case may be. So I think that's good to set expectations. Probably good to err on the side of more rather than less. But you can also set things to we're away during outside business hours. So in Facebook, you can set your business hours so that people know if it's 11 o'clock on a Friday night that you're away and that you may not be able to respond. You've got away messages, kind of like almost like out of office messages that you can set up in Outlook, and then instant replies too. So you might want to set up an instant reply where you can say, thank you so much for contacting Evanston 301. We will respond to you as quickly as we're able to or whatever the case may be.
It's important that you specify because for us, although we're 24/7,
right,
our admin staff that administers our social media is not 24/7.
Exactly.
So you have to, set those expectations.
Yeah.
Even though the staff that is monitoring social media does not work 24/7.
Yeah.
There isn't someone always here. So.
No, that's a great point. And sometimes, I'm sure you've received this, where it'll be 11 o'clock on a Friday night, and it's a time-sensitive issue, and they really should be contacting police non-emergency or even 911, and they're sending it through a Facebook message, and that can be a little bit troublesome. So I think that we have to all do a little bit education, as you're saying, to kind of channel that a little bit better. This is kind of cool too. They just added recently this Facebook Messenger code, not to be outdone by Snapchat. Snapchat's had these snap codes for a while. They're kind of like QR codes, but you can go into your settings and you can actually create or get your code for your page. And then you can share this on materials and print and so forth. So you can say connect with Evanston 301, via Facebook Messenger, and this is the QR, it's kind of like a QR code. And then they're able to take a picture of that with their Facebook Messenger app, and then it'll connect them to your page that way. So this is kind of cool that they added this more recently. I think they actually did a nice job in the design too. Facebook Live, are there any agencies that have been using Facebook Live to interact with their citizens or residents? Anyone doing that yet? Experimenting? So we've been doing a little bit and we want to do more. I think City of Las Vegas is one of my favorite cities for social in general, but they're doing a really nice job with Facebook Live. Now granted, City of Las Vegas, it's a big community. They've got a team of folks on their communications and PIO team and social media team, but they're doing some really cool stuff and they do this one thing called the Daily Dose every day. And I'm not saying we have to do it every day. Maybe we do it once a week, maybe we do it once a month, I don't know. But It's just, it's, I think it's really well done. It's not like super scripted. It's very authentic. It's informal. It's maybe 2 or 3 minutes and just kind of a rundown of what's going on in the city, maybe that day or that week. This one was done a few days ago. This is a major intersection in downtown Las Vegas, and they're doing some major construction. It's like a 2-year project. It's gonna be a huge disruption to traffic and so forth. But in the end, it's gonna be great for bikers and pedestrians. It's gonna be a kind of almost a revitalization project in the downtown of Las Vegas. And so basically they're trying to get out in front of this before the construction starts, educate residents, be honest that there is gonna be some inconveniences, but in the long run, this is gonna be great for everyone. So, and then they mix it up, like at the end, then they talk about they've got some job postings for firefighters and the communications team and so forth. So I just think it's well done. So if you're not already following the City of Las Vegas on Facebook, you might want to do that. One of the cool things about Facebook Live is if you follow the let's say City of Las Vegas in this case, and they go live, you get a little alert in Facebook. So I think that that's prompting additional people to engage in real time. Even if you miss them live, then Facebook will archive that video on the Facebook news feed. So it's there to stay and people can come along later and watch it. It'll say, you know, City of Las Vegas was live. You know, you can play the video and catch up if you can't catch it in real time. I think Facebook is also skewing intentionally videos, especially Facebook Live videos, to show up in the news feed so that the engagement and the organic reach is very good. So I think that video in general is huge right now, whether it's Snapchat, Facebook, Instagram. I saw they just increased their minimum length for videos. So I would encourage folks in your who are doing social in your agencies to strongly consider video. It doesn't have to be professionally done necessarily, and sometimes it's almost better if it is spontaneous, impromptu, just a couple folks in the communications team working together, and there's no cost to do that. So. Any questions about Facebook Live or live video in general, or comments or questions about that? Twitter. So I want to talk about Twitter just a little bit. There's been some discussion in the last 6, maybe even up to 12 months about, you know, Twitter, what are they going to be when they grow up? How are they going to monetize? And there's kind of been some back and forth on this. I still believe, I think there was a gentleman yesterday, one of the vendors, he was talking about when his flight is late, what's the first thing he does? He tweets, right? And if you think about that, that is kind of the natural instinct for most folks who are on social, who are social savvy or whatever. If they have a customer service issue, a compliment, a complaint, an inquiry, pretty much Twitter is still the go-to platform. So despite the fact that they've plateaued a little bit and on users and maybe engagement and so forth, if you think about it from a customer service standpoint, which is, you know, the focus of course today for us, that's, I still am very bullish on Twitter for that purpose. So if you don't already have a Twitter account for your 301 account, that's probably the one account. There was a gentleman here yesterday that asked me, what's the one platform that you would invest in? If we, let's say we're not really doing social at all, what's the one platform you would invest in? I initially said Facebook, and then I corrected my answer. I said, actually, from a contact center 301 customer service standpoint, Twitter would definitely be my first choice still today. Actually, you had the question, so I'm amending my answer a little bit. But Facebook in general is awesome for community engagement, citizen interaction, telling stories, sharing videos, doing the live videos that we talked about. But I think if you're talking about straight up customer service and constituent service, and also being proactive, like actively monitoring, and I included on here, you know, Hootsuite, Sprout Social, Buffer, these are terrific tools to help you manage the fire hose of information on Twitter. If your agencies are not using these tools, literally Hootsuite, they have a free plan, they have a $10 a month plan, they have an enterprise plan. You can get started with these, you know, free or very inexpensive plans, very affordable. I would also talk to your communications and PIO folks if they, maybe they're doing this email thing where like they're managing Twitter, but then they're emailing you or calling you, and it's kind of like this back and forth and so forth. See if they can add you as a team member to Hootsuite or Sprout Social or whatever platform they're using to manage this, because that might be easier to be able to manage those requests via those management tools. And Twitter Flight School. Sometimes Twitter can be confusing to folks. It's kind of a little bit quirky. It's kind of a little bit different than the other traditional Facebook, and now LinkedIn even kind of looks like Facebook and so on and so forth. So Twitter actually offers their own flight, what they call Flight School now. It's free. It's well done. It's kept up to date, obviously, because Twitter's managing it. So I would encourage you to check this out. It's twitterflightschool.com, and you can start it and stop it and pick up again. You log into Twitter and you're off and running. So that's a great resource for you or for your staff if you want to ramp them up on Twitter. And one other thing we talked about yesterday in one of our roundtables is, you know, I realize some of the call centers are very large. You might have 50 or more customer service representatives. And maybe it's not realistic to have all 50 plus folks trained on Twitter, right? So I think that's a great opportunity where maybe you start small, 2, 3, 4 people, you get them ramped up on Twitter or other social media platforms and see where that goes. And you know, maybe not everybody has to be a Twitter expert. Some people may be terrific on the phone or even good at SMS and texting, but maybe Twitter is not their thing. And just because they do Facebook at home, it's not the same, as you all know. It's just a different situation. You have to think differently. You're as a page admin, it's different than posting videos of your kids on Facebook personally. So, I overheard someone talk about social media policies. I don't have slides on that today, but I've done a lot of work in that. So if you have questions about social media policy, security, or archiving, you know, please feel free to reach out to me. I wasn't going to hit that too hard today, but I've got a lot of experience in dealing with that across many agencies.
Yeah, it's
critical, but it's totally doable, and there's great templates out there that are available. Archiving is another important one, especially now that we've got all these different platforms and we have to think about our communications and as we're communicating with folks, how is that stuff getting captured and archived? So if there is a Freedom of Information request or something similar, how do we deal with that? Just want to touch on Periscope briefly. Periscope is a live streaming app that is actually owned by Twitter. It was in development, it was kind of in stealth mode, and then Twitter actually bought it before they even went public. They've actually only been around a little over a year, but they've already hit something crazy, 200 million broadcasts by their first birthday. But what's really nice is that it's totally integrated with Twitter, so it works very similar to Facebook Live. So maybe your agency isn't big on Facebook, or maybe they don't even have a Facebook page, but they like Twitter, that's great. Periscope is your answer then to Facebook Live. And it works nicely with Twitter, and they just, in the last few days, I think, they changed it. So now it used to disappear after 24 hours from the Twitter feed. Now it stays. So that's a nice feature. LinkedIn, I use LinkedIn literally every day. I'm a fan of LinkedIn. I think it's a very useful platform for a whole host of reasons. I'm a fan, and I'm also bullish on it. I realize for government, it's a little bit different. I think every government agency should have a LinkedIn page if they don't already. I think there's lots of reasons that you can share economic development stories, job openings, all kinds of things. For 301 centers, it's a little bit different. Maybe if you're a very large center like Chicago and you're hiring lots of people all the time, maybe it makes sense to have your own dedicated pages. But a newer thing that LinkedIn recently launched is what they're calling showcase pages. And I really like this concept for government agencies. I think this was just an accident that it worked out for us in this case. But with LinkedIn showcase pages, you can have your main city or county LinkedIn page, and then you can create these showcase pages. So think about maybe police, fire, public works, whatever division or department, you can create showcase pages. So it's still under the city or county umbrella, but you can have just a dedicated page. And I think it's just a great way to, I think we're hiring firefighters in the coming weeks here. And that might be a great place to create a fire department showcase page. That way the fire department doesn't have to go off and create their own LinkedIn page. It's just creating one showcase page. It's free. I included a link here about showcase pages. So I would inquire with your folks at your agency, if you do have a LinkedIn page for your agency, see if they maybe would consider setting up a showcase page for 301 if it's appropriate, if it makes sense for y'all. So Instagram is another platform that's seen tremendous growth. It's really the first of the major platforms that was mobile first. Facebook, Twitter, and Pinterest came of age before mobile. Instagram is the first big six social media platform that came of age in a post-mobile or post-desktop era. It remains to have really good engagement, really good numbers, particularly with millennials. So definitely if your target audience is to connect with folks under the age of 40 or under the age of 35, Instagram is still an excellent option. you know, it's a little bit different for 301. You know, is it worth setting up an Instagram account for a 301, a dedicated 301 account? Probably not. What I would do is I would try to work with your agency to, you know, can you communicate, can you share stories with them so that they can share them on the Instagram page? We, at one point, I think it was 2 years ago, we had like 100 followers on Instagram, and like a year later, someone else on our team just took it and ran with it. She did a great job, and she grew it from 100 followers to like 1,100 followers in 1 year. So just to give you an idea of the growth that's still occurring in the platform. This was a cool picture of Lake Michigan that somebody sent in to us from about 6 weeks ago. Got 124 likes. I mean, literally just took a couple minutes. Someone was nice enough to send this in. We shared it on Instagram, and it got terrific engagement. So, and that's what a lot of agencies are doing. Roanoke, Virginia, for example, does a terrific job on social media. But if you look at their accounts, so much of what they're doing is really, truly crowdsourced, where they're just taking pictures or photos from residents, maybe it's of a storm or something going on in town or so forth, and they're sharing it, and it does really well, and it doesn't cost them anything, takes a couple minutes, they credit the person who sent in the photo, and they're off and running. It's not unlike what, you know, the 10 o'clock news, you know, when they're asking people to send in photos and they're sharing those photos. It's kind of a similar concept to that. Pinterest, kind of similar to Instagram. You know, again, I'm not recommending that 301 or Contact Center set up their own Pinterest account, but Pinterest is still a huge platform. It was actually only second on that one chart. It was only second to Facebook as far as penetration. I still think that there's lots of room, whether it's cultural arts or economic development or other things that agencies can leverage Pinterest for. Again, for 301, it's a little bit different, but I think that there are cases where you, as 301 or customer service or contact centers, can still tell your story by working with the Pinterest page. So something to consider if your agency's not already. YouTube, we've used YouTube in a couple of examples. We actually have all of our council videos and all of our videos that we do, we actually do store on YouTube. But we've also done ones that I would say that are kind of 301 targeted or 301 focused. This was one that we did, I think, about a year and a half ago when we launched new parking meters here in town that accept credit cards. And we knew that that was going to be a big change. And we put together, I think it's like about a 3-minute video. And I think it was pretty effective. And I think that this is a great example of where 301 can benefit from being proactive, having a nice video done, explaining how this works to cut down on confusion, calls, emails, tweets, whatever the case may be. Snapchat, obviously everyone's probably heard of Snapchat now. It's definitely the hottest platform now, and probably, you know, in that 13 to 30 year old range, it's just absolutely on fire. You know, some people refer to it now as a Snapchat generation. It truly is kind of the gateway platform for this group of folks. And I think it's important to remember too, like some people might be dismissive, well, this is just for teenagers and folks in their 20s and we're not necessarily focused on that age group. But these folks do grow up, they age up, and I think it's important, you know, on their 31st birthday or their 36th birthday, they're not going to deactivate their Snapchat accounts.
If you see where the two climbers are climbing Mount Everest and they are documenting their climb with Snapchat.
Yeah, and actually it's funny you mentioned my my second cousin is actually in that group on Mount Everest. Yeah, and so yeah, but Snapchat. I mean, I think it's just totally coincidental that you said that. He's my second cousin. I can take no credit for this, but he's actually trying to set a world record for scaling the 7 summits in the world, and then the North Pole and the South Pole. So Mount Everest is next on his list, and he's with that group. And it's pretty cool because I guess Mount Everest hasn't been fully scaled in 3 years because of avalanches, and I think now they may be able to get there. But that is an excellent example that Snapchat partnered with them and they're sharing this story. And I think that, I don't think there's any other platform that could have captured it as well as Snapchat has. So thank you for mentioning that. Hopefully they'll be safe. But
I'm over 35, but I enjoyed that.
Yeah, but it's interesting. I was talking to a I was talking to a woman in her 50s, and somehow Snapchat came up, and she goes, I use Snapchat all the time. I'm like, what? And it's because her daughter's on Snapchat, and that's how they communicate, and that's how they message each other. They're not using SMS in this case, they're using Snapchat generally. So, or, you know, she's trying to keep up with what her daughter's up to, too. So,
yes.
And that's good, too. So I think it's, you know, sometimes I think, especially in social media, sometimes you'll hear like these kind of dramatic statements like, no millennial uses Facebook or no teenager uses Facebook. I just saw something last night, eMarketer said the number one platform for teenagers as far as penetration is concerned is actually Facebook. Now, you can argue how much they're using it and how much they're engaging with it and what they're deciding to share with it. I think a lot of them are using it for Facebook Messenger and not so much sharing pictures of them at a party. They're saving that stuff for Snapchat and other platforms. But so I think we always got to be careful, you know, when we say, well, Snapchat's just for kids or whatever. It's all these platforms are evolving. So City of Las Vegas, to use Las Vegas one more time, City of Las Vegas is actually doing a nice job with Snapchat. So if you have a Snapchat account or you're thinking about creating one personally to try out and play with, be sure to follow City of Las. I think their handle is just at City of Las, or City of Las Vegas. City of Las Vegas, I believe. And speaking of Las Vegas, these are three communities that I just think that are really doing well on social, so I wanted to just highlight them briefly. Lenexa, there's a gal, Kristen Wagner, she's been doing social for about 4 years there. It's a community of about 48,000, so it's not a huge community. I think she's kind of a one-person shop, kind of a jack of all trades, and she's just a great practitioner. So I would encourage you to follow their Facebook, Twitter, and other accounts. Same thing with Roanoke, Virginia. Its population of about 100,000. Tim Martin is the coordinator there. He does a terrific job, and I'm just a fan of what he's done there in a community of 100,000. And then of course Las Vegas. Las Vegas is a bigger example of a community I think is really doing well with social. They just launched a new website too, and just kind of pushing the envelope on different things. So I want to transition a little bit out of social into messaging. This was a chart, and you'll see this, the shift actually happened a little over a year ago, where the big four messaging apps, which I think includes Facebook Messenger, Viber, WeChat, and WhatsApp, are in the big four messaging apps, and they compared to the big four social networking apps, and now you can see that that messaging is actually outgrowing social. Obviously, social is here to stay probably for a very long time, and it will continue to evolve, and some of the platforms continue to grow, and new ones are going to come. I don't know if anyone's heard of Peach. That's kind of like the newest and the latest and greatest thing. We'll see if that actually takes off and becomes the next Snapchat. But Elias did a nice job of talking about how popular SMS is and the sheer volume that SMS has. This is a great example of the sheer volume of messaging apps. Here's another chart that shows you, look at the trajectory for WhatsApp. It's just unbelievable. Or even Facebook Messenger. WeChat is a messaging app focused in China, although it's spreading beyond China. And it's also really evolving. In some ways, WeChat is arguably the most innovative platform right now. It started out mostly as a messaging app, but now it's kind of blown into a full-blown social platform. We'll see if it eventually takes off here in the United States. There's a lot of competition here, so it may not. And even Instagram and Snapchat have had terrific growth in the last couple of years, but still can't compare to the messaging apps. So just briefly about WhatsApp, it's now owned by Facebook. Facebook bought it for $19 billion with a B a couple of years ago, which just goes to show you how much attention, and I think they have over a billion users now. And just this week, there's been a lot of developments just this week as this conference has been going on. A couple days ago, they launched a desktop version of the app. It was a mobile-first app, and the reason that people were using WhatsApp, the primary reason was to avoid paying for SMS and going over the limits and so forth. So they were using and leveraging WhatsApp to communicate via the web as opposed to going through SMS networks and racking up text messages and so forth and going over their limit. And WhatsApp is really popular with people in the United States being able to communicate with friends and family in Europe and Mexico and so forth. So that's been part of the organic growth as well. Are there anyone who's using WhatsApp or have family members who are using WhatsApp? Okay. So I think that they're, full disclaimer, I realize, we don't have time for everything. We can't be on every single last platform, but I think we want to at least be paying attention to some of these ones that are, when it hits a billion users, it's pretty significant. So I think that, especially now that they've got a desktop version where it makes it easier, this is a quick snapshot from their blog from yesterday. that it starts to become more manageable for us. You know, it doesn't make sense for us to be juggling literally cell phones as we're trying to communicate with residents. But now that we've got tools like this with Facebook Messenger and WhatsApp, I think it should at least be on our radar and something to consider. These are some other really popular messaging apps. Some of you might be familiar with these. You might have kids or teenagers in your family that are using some of these. Kik seems to be really popular, at least in the Chicago area, among young folks. Line, I mentioned WeChat earlier, that's the one from China. And then Viber is another one that's kind of on fire right now. And these platforms are evolving. They're not just simple, you know, text messaging back and forth now. Now they're doing voice calling, video chat and conferencing and so forth. So it's really an exciting time on this front. This is something I'm really excited about too. And I just, I asked my wife if we could get one of these and she said no, and I'm gonna try again. But I think it only costs like $100 and some. It's not particularly expensive. Is anyone familiar with this? Okay, quite a few people. Anyone have one yet? You do. What do you think?
It's awesome. So far, women seem to like it more than men.
Women like it more than men?
That's what I've experienced.
Okay, because of the commerce aspect, or?
Yes. It seems that voice, seems to be a more natural channel for women. Mm.
Yeah.
Like men are weird about trying it, and women are like, do the dishes for me.
Right.
Like, they're trying every single thing, like, just trying.
More experimental.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So kind of explain exactly.
Yeah. So, and it's interesting, it's kind of been a silent runaway hit for Amazon, but basically, and I'll let you jump in too if you want to explain. But basically, it's almost like Siri, right? So a lot of us have iPhones and we ask Siri questions and ask Siri to do things or give us directions or whatever. It's a brilliant move by Amazon because, of course, Amazon wants you to buy stuff from Amazon, right? So it might be as simple as, you know, Alexa, you know, please order diapers, right? Or something like that. And it knows who you are. It has your credit card on file. And within a few seconds, yeah, the diapers are ordered, and the next day they're on your doorstep.
I think where it gets really interesting is there's other stuff that's happening that you can do through it that isn't just dependent on Amazon's existing services. So
right.
They're allowing other companies to connect their services through that speaker.
Right.
So for example, OneReach is working on a prototype. If anybody's used Home Advisor, does anyone know Home Advisor?
Yeah.
Like you can order home services, plumber, electrician. We're working on a prototype where you could just say to that speaker, get me a plumber to my house by 2:00 tomorrow. And it's like, okay. And it just finds you one in some way.
Right. Right. Yeah. And I think they're doing integrations with, if they haven't already, I think Uber and other apps like that and other services like that.
Yeah,
so
yeah. It's very early.
I think it's been maybe a year at the most. And now they have other versions. They have like smaller versions of this now that just came out in the last couple months. But I think where we're going, the reason I wanted to mention this is, first of all, it's going to grow quickly here, I think. And Amazon's behind it. It's going to be a success. It's already a success. But I think we're going to get to the point where they have a software developer kit, which means anyone can build into this now, can build an app or connect with it. So we could get to the point where literally we're saying, hey, Alexa, do I owe the city of Evanston for a parking ticket? And Alexa will answer, and it'll say, yes, you do, it's $75, would you like to pay? With your card ending in 0152, yes. Thank you, your purchase is complete, we're now emailing you a receipt.
It's important to clarify, it's not going to get to that point, it is at that point.
Yeah.
You can do that, it's just.
Yeah, we're not there yet as far as us, but yes, we're The platform is there, the software development kit is there, and I think it's going to be time for probably government to get there, to get to that point where you can ask questions and get answers. I could see in the next couple of years, like I think Audrey mentioned, like 70% of your calls are really just people asking for information. So I think it can get to the point where you can ask this, how much are the parking garages in Evanston? And it'll be able to answer how much per hour the parking garage is and so forth. So. It's pretty wild stuff, yeah.
It's not as hard as it seems either.
Yeah, they've done a really nice job. They have a whole community for developers who want to build onto this platform. So, like you said, it's really, it's not even like this is the future. It's like this is kind of here already.
Just to give you a sense, the Home Advisor thing, like asking for 2 days. It was ready in 2 days.
Yeah.
That's a 75-year-old lady in my church introduced me to this, so it's very easy.
Yeah. Yeah. I think Lily from Acela, I think she shared this slide yesterday. So this is, you know, kind of our philosophy is where possible. You know, we've got this terrific 301 center. We want to be able to communicate with people in the ways that they're comfortable with. So we've tried to always, where we can, you know, try and do a multi-channel or omni-channel approach. So we've got obviously voice, and I want to be clear, as much as I'm a tech and digital geek, you know, voice calls are not going away anytime soon. It's kind of almost like the newspaper analogy, like people who consume newspaper content, I just saw this, like a Pew Research thing, 51% of people who consume newspaper content are still print only, and then there's like a whole nother chunk of 25% that are print and web. So 3 out of 4 people are still looking at some form of print, even in addition to digital and apps and online and so forth. But it's the same thing with voice, but obviously, going forward over the next several years, we're going to see shifts, right? And people are going to be more natural to using SMS or texting or apps and so forth. So where possible, we've always tried to, with the help of OneReach as a vendor, we were able to take our 301 phone number, a 10-digit 311 phone number, and make it a smart 301 phone number, right? So that you could text to it and do live two-way texting. And so we've offered that for a couple of years now. And then I'm going to have a couple of other examples of where we can interact with our 301 phone number. And, we actually first launched with web chat. That was the first thing we did. We use a company called SnapEngage to manage the web chat process. But the cool thing is they have an integration with OneReach, so you can actually manage both the texts and the web chats from the same interface. OneReach also offers the ability to do web chat too, so that's an alternative as well. One concern that we always had with when we launched the live two-way texting with 301 is we wanted to make sure, kind of what Audrey is talking about, you have to set expectations even if you are there after hours or later or whatever. So we have, if someone tries to contact us after hours, we do have a message set up so that people know that maybe you want to, you might want to consider calling 911 if it really is an emergency, or here's the police non-emergency number so you can go out to the service desk. And then we also set expectations as to when we can respond to text messages. So I have a couple examples where we took our 301 phone number and now I've inserted this language bot. It wasn't called a bot when we created these, but essentially that's what they are. So of course we're in the Chicago area. We have some pretty harsh winters sometimes. This past winter actually wasn't too bad, but when we have a certain amount of snow, we have to go into what we call like a snow parking emergency, and there's all these rules and it's a big deal, and we try to communicate with residents so that they know. And sometimes it might be 10 o'clock at night and they're curious as to you know, if a snow parking ban is in effect or not. And we set it up with OneReach that you can text the word snow to our 301 phone number and it'll bounce back and let you know whether or not parking restrictions are in effect. And it has a short link to more information so people can get that. Another example that we used is we were doing this I Heart Evanston Trees campaign, and we wanted people to be able to, a quick way for them to be able to donate to the fund. It's almost like when you see a TV commercial, say text, you know, 1234 to this to donate $5 to the Red Cross, almost kind of like trying to play off of that kind of thing. So we set up a short code, trees, and all of these cases with these quote bots, you know, there's no interaction. We're not having to do anything from a staff perspective. These are just all automated. We're just using these keywords, so in this case, trees, and it bounces back a secure link for people to be able to donate to the I Heart Evanston Trees Fund. Another cool one that we worked on was the ability to offer restaurant inspection scores, so that if you're about to walk into a restaurant and you're curious as to how they're doing on their health inspection scores, you can text the word food to our 301 phone number, and then also the name of the restaurant, in this case Peckish Pig, which is on Howard Street, and it shoots back the score, in this case 98 out of 100, and the date that they were inspected on. So this has been, especially when we first launched it, there was a lot of attention, a lot of people thought that was pretty cool. We also have our restaurant inspection data in a certain standard so that we can share it with Yelp. So if you go to Yelp in Evanston, you'll be able to see the restaurant inspection scores and also the violations if they have violations. So again, it's a restaurant inspection bot. I wanted to briefly mention Slack. Is anyone familiar with Slack or heard of Slack? So Slack is it's almost like an internal messaging tool. The idea is to kind of cut down on email. I wanted to mention this because I think we're going to see more adoption of this in government. And now you've got the ability to build into Slack. I think OneReach offers an integration now with Slack to be able to build bots. And I think that this will only continue to grow. The one problem right now is there's kind of a free plan, and then there's a paid plan. The free plan caps out like at 10,000 messages, and then there's archiving issues. So I'm hoping that as the platform evolves, there'll be other options for government to be able to use Slack, or now there's competitors to Slack that have sprung up. So I just wanted to put this on your radar as an app or a software program that's blowing up, and it may be useful for your agency going forward. Cut down on email, and also it's kind of like replacing intranets, like especially at private sector companies, they're kind of getting away from the old clunky intranet that nobody visits. And it's a way to be able to message people. You can create groups and communicate with each other. You can upload files and share, you know, like file sharing and so forth, images. So hopefully there'll be a path forward for government to be able to use this affordably and also deal with the archiving issues that we have to deal with that private sector typically doesn't have to. It's a little bit like Google Docs. Yeah, sort of.
It
yeah.
Sounds like maybe a combination of Google Docs and Skype.
Yes, and I think they're actually, if they haven't already, I think they're working on being able to do voice stuff. And then also you can build in third-party integrations. I think even like CNN and other of it. So like if you want headline news from CNN, then you do / CNN and it's that kind of stuff. So it's really developer-friendly.
So eventually will all of these be able to talk to each other, because we use just regular email.
Right.
And I received a document that was in Google Docs, and there was no way for me to open
for,
it. So I had to
yeah.
go back to them and say, whoa, you got to do this another way.
Yeah. I think that is the one thing going forward, whether it's the software that we're talking about today or even the vendor software and so forth. I think now everybody realizes that we've got to be able to communicate. We've got to have APIs so that programs can talk to each other, or that you can be able to get data exported easily so you can get it up on an open data platform. So I think everybody now in 2016 has figured this out, and we're hopefully over the next year or two going to have less friction and more seamless what you're talking about, being able to communicate.
And I'm not the techie person, so can you tell me what BOT stands for?
Oh, so bot is like, it's like short for like robot or chat bot.
Okay.
And basically, you know, like these things where now you can text snow to our 301 phone number and automatically get an answer, yes or no. That's basically a bot.
That's a bot.
That's a bot, yeah. And bot's a pretty big umbrella, and Elias is going to touch more on bots as well. CNN just launched this one. You know, we were talking earlier about the Facebook Messenger QR code kind of thing. So now if you go to facebook.com/CNN, this is what you see right now, and you can actually snap this code, and then you can connect with CNN, and it's basically a bot again. It's like a news bot, and so you can ask for the top stories, you can ask for sports. It starts to learn what you like, which is really amazing. This is kind of in this whole like AI or artificial intelligence where these machines are learning about us. I mean, even the Facebook news feed really is, that's what it's doing, right? It's learning what you like, what you don't like, what you want to see more of, what you're reading, and it learns over time. Same thing with the CNN bot. It's like a news bot, basically.
When you say snap this code, what do you mean?
So if you have Facebook Messenger on your phone, there's I think it's under the people or contacts button, there's a spot for you to be able to snap a code, and then you hold your phone up to this code and take a picture of it, and then it connects you to CNN's news bot, in this case, as an example.
Thank you.
And the same, and we can create those now with your agencies. If you go in, as a page admin, if you go into settings, you'll be able to find your code. Let's see, how are we doing on time, Elias? 10:16. I think we're doing pretty good, actually. I have a quick, like 2-minute video that I wanted to show, and then we're gonna pivot into talking more about bots. Elias is gonna basically talk about, you know, again, kind of what the heck is a bot, some examples of bots, and then, you know, time permitting, he's going to actually walk you through how you could build a bot using their platform with a free trial. And if you like it, you can be off and running with it. So does that sound about right?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me queue up this 2-minute video, and then we'll switch over to Elias's presentation. Let me just set up the video. Again, it's about maybe a two and a half minute clip that I'm going to show. Basically, this happened this week, this past Monday, at an event called TechCrunch Disrupt, I think it's called, in New York City. This gentleman happens to be from Barrington, not too far away, but he's like one of the co-founders of Siri. And basically, this is kind of like the new Siri, like Siri 2.0 or Siri on steroids or however you want to describe it. They're calling it Viv, V-I-V, and it's pretty cool. It's kind of like really taking Siri to the next step. So I would just want to show you a couple examples. This is kind of, this falls under the umbrella of conversational commerce. Now, these examples are private sector, but I think there's a lot that, as you watch these examples, that I think that they're going to spill over to the public sector or things that we can adapt.
What I'm going to do now is show you where we put our emphasis on the initial development of this. This is something we call conversational commerce. So the goal here is, how easy can you make it to get things done by talking to things, right? So let me give you a few examples. Send Adam $20 for the drinks last night. Okay, our friends from Venmo come up. It knows who Adam is. It knows what it's about. We're going to go ahead and send that. That's it. It's done. Adam's got his money. One sentence, and it's done. Let me continue. Send my mom some flowers for her birthday. Our friends from ProFlowers come up with some beautiful arrangements here. But, well, she is a tulip lover. Let's try that. What about tulips? Great. So, some beautiful arrangements here. I'm going to go ahead and do that. Knows where my mother lives. Seamlessly puts all that together, and we'll go ahead and buy that. That's it. Flowers are on the way. Right? Let's keep going. Give me a nice room in Palm Springs for Labor Day weekend. Our friends at Hotels.com come up with some cool options. Hey, I've stayed at the Andreas Hotel before. It's pretty nice. So I'm going to go ahead and get that. I think the deluxe room would be good. And let's book that. Has anyone ever seen a hotel booking that's that simple before? Come on, you guys, this is exciting. Alright, let's do one more. I need a ride for 6 people from my office to Madison Square Garden. So our friends from Uber can help us out here. Of course, they know that Viv knows that a car that takes 6 people requires an SUV or an XL. We're going to request the ride. All right, now they're looking. All right. Well, I'm sorry, Robert. I'm going to have to cancel this ride today, but hopefully we get a chance in the future. To cancel that. Oh.
So what do you think?
Awesome.
It's pretty awesome. And it's here. Like, they're launching later this year, this product. So it's pretty wild. But you can start to see, these were private sector examples or commerce examples, but you can start to see what the impact could be for us in a really cool way. So with that, should we switch over? So we're going to switch laptops here so he can present. Any quick questions or comments or thoughts while we're setting up?
We're going to take a quick.
Want to take a quick
break?
Should we do that? You want to take a quick, like, 2-minute break, and then we'll get back to bots? Okay.
So at the end, can you guys all hear?
phases?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, how are we on time? How much?
Yeah, half hour.
Wow, all right.
Four.
I have a little bit more. 120 minutes?
160. On his clock.
So, thanks for including this part. I think that this will be really interesting for everybody here. So, Luke mentioned bots a few times, and there's a lot of connections right now in the world with bots. And as you said, it's a relatively new. Well, really, it's a new name for an old concept. The simplest description of it being automation that has some intelligence behind it that allows you to basically interact with a robot, right? Where your voice or language or messaging is the interface instead of using software, dragging a mouse or typing something. There was one thing I wanted to add that I was thinking about along the way, that especially as you were showing the new version of Siri, that, I don't know about others, if others were thinking of this along the way, that when we watched that Siri video, the part that I'm really excited about is when it gets to a point where, I don't know if anybody noticed, when he was showing his phone on the screen, and it was, you know, book that hotel, he was using voice to drive the results that came up. So it was sort of like voice-controlled searching, but he was still clicking on things on his screen. Mm-hmm. So when he had to book it, he couldn't say book it. He had to click book it.
Or
so
cancel,
I'm,
so he didn't say
yeah, it. I'm waiting for that moment where, I mean, it's kind of scary at the same time, but it's really exciting to me that there's some moment where you don't even have to look at your screen. Like, you know, your phone doesn't even have to be up. Yeah.
So I guess I have one concern, and that is when I'm actually using stuff like voice automation.
Yeah.
I have been on the phone, and my dog barks in the background, and then who knows what my dog's going to order. I just want to.
Yeah.
But Apple does a great job with that. Whatever solution Apple is using, we can mess up a number and say scratch it, or just say or replace
yeah.
it. And they are doing a phenomenal job with but Merrill Lynch is not. My former employer.
Okay. Your husband's employer.
Oh, yes. Oh, they're doing wonderful.
Yeah. Did you have another question?
No, I was just saying that there are some times where even when you're trying to pay a bill or you're using voice automation, if they can't hear you properly, you have to repeat it over and over again or they'll say something incorrect.
Yeah.
So I you know, I'm similar with you. I'm very careful. I want to be able to make sure that they've done the right thing. So,
yeah.
I mean, you know.
It's tough. So it's interesting to see how this stuff is coming together. And there's a lot of. I'm sure it'll never stop changing, just like the rest of technology. But the interesting thing, I think part of why it made sense to have me offer an opportunity to connect a little more with bots is, you know, obviously it's something that's becoming a craze, and a lot of mainstream media has been writing about it as an important part of the business world and technology, even for government, and part of why it made sense for us to come in and talk about it and share some of this with you is even though the term bot has surfaced as like the name for this type of conversational automation. As I said before, it's not really that new of a technology, and our company is a testament to that. The software that we build, it's a bot building tool. It's just, there wasn't really a name for that until like 6 months ago. So the interesting thing is some of our customers, even ones that have been on board for years, you know, they see a quote in Bloomberg, like, bots are what's happening, and some of our existing customers came to us and said, this bot thing looks incredible, like, we should be doing something there, right? Like, what can WonderEach help us with? And we point them out and say, well, you have automated, you can change your booking through texting, and your company already offers that. That's a bot. The only reason it's not a bot is because you didn't call it a bot. you didn't market it that way. And so it's really interesting, like, oh, we need bots, we need bots. Like, a lot of our customers have been saying that, and we give them a tutorial of the solution they already have and say, here's your new bot. And then it switches really fast and they get it. And so a lot of the time the difference is just how it's positioned and marketed, and that's an important part of it that we'll talk about as well. There are, as Luke was getting to, there's starting to be bots for everything. Like, you can order a sandwich, I still can't get my cheeseburger in my hotel room at the hotel that I'm at, but that is any day now, I know it. I just haven't stayed at hotels that do it, but I know that there are some that do things like that, where you can just text the hotel and say, cheeseburger, and it confirms that you want a cheeseburger to your room. It already knows your name, credit card, and room number, so you get that cheeseburger.
I have a little plug for Virgin Hotels. You can actually unlock your room, control your temperature, do all kinds of stuff from your phone.
Yeah, so this is kind of the moment that I've been waiting for. I'm part of the last generation. It's really cool to be able to say this. I'm part of the last generation ever that remembers life before internet. So literally, like, people that were starting high school when I was leaving high school don't know what life was like without the internet. They have no memory of it at all, whereas I do. And there's others in the room that do as well. I think we have just as folks that were around before computers were showing up and dominant. People that were already in their professional careers at that point have a really different and important perspective on technology. I think the generation that I'm in also, and there's others in the room, that I think we also have a weird perspective that's not gonna exist again, and weird in a good way. But anyway, one piece that's going to be an important part of what we go through today is because how this type of bot and conversational stuff is evolving, it's very important that it's becoming less technical, like in terms of the creation and management of it. I should note before we start actually getting into some of the details, I'm not a technical person. I'm getting a look. My background is in design research and anthropology. Okay, so I don't know how to code. I'm the least technical person in my entire company. Like, I get support from our support team probably as much as our customers do. I'm not the guy for technology. So that's part of why I'm an advocate of whether it's OneReach or not, just technology that's doing the type of things that we're doing. Because it is allowing people that don't know how to code, that don't really get the languages of programming, that aren't behind the scenes, to envision and bring to life these same types of experiences that Luke was talking about, that we're gonna talk more about. Quote from yesterday, and from GovDelivery, right? So we're talking about, obviously, a major theme of all of these conversations, right? Improving customer experience. These are very good. Oh, it's doing it again.
That's
really, yeah.
Careful.
It's okay.
Yeah,
it'll be easier this time. That's fine. I can step two extra steps and change all the slides. Great quote from Time that I think is one of the most concise ways of describing what's going on with bots. A lot of the design and technology world has said bots are the new interface or user interface, or UI, right? And there's this idea that, I love the way that this is described, no UI is the new UI, right? That software is not required. There's no interface needed. We're already communicating over texting, over voice. That's the interface.
Explain user interface, or UI.
User interface is, in a way, not meaning to sound like a jerk, it's what it sounds like. It's how you interface with anything as a user, right? So this microphone doesn't do me much good
sitting on this, right? So in order to interface with the microphone the way it's meant to deliver its value, I have to grab it and hold it, or it has to be clipped to me, right? Software has the same concepts.
right? When you're interacting with software, you're clicking through, you're going down a menu, you go down this path or that path. Conceptually, that's the same way as how I interface with this room. I need to get to that hallway, I'm gonna go over here and go out the door, right? Through software, I'm doing the same type of thing. I'm going down certain paths, and there's a lot of analogies between buildings and architecture and technology as well. So the idea that that no interface, it's a confusing concept, but I think it's an important one. It's this idea that we're arriving at a moment in technology where there's been a lot of, I think, overhype and technology for the sake of technology. And I think, to me, as somebody that's not very technical, this is a wonderful moment. This is a time where technology and the leaders and smartest people in technology are saying, it doesn't have to be that complicated. Actually, it should be simple. There's intuitive, natural ways that we're already doing things. And there's a great, actually, for those that are interested, please write this down. There's a fantastic TED Talk from a guy named Toby Shapshak, who's, he is a, he writes all about technology, but he's not a technology guy. So he's like this, we have similar backgrounds actually, sort of an anthropology and people person that's fascinated with the effects on culture from technology. And he did this TED Talk a few years ago that's been viewed, you know, however many millions of times about how, I think it's called You Don't Need an App for That. And the whole thing is about how years ago, Africa's been years ahead of the rest of the world by basically, being resourceful and coming up with applications that are managed via SMS. Like we're in the rest of the world where people have smartphones and are spending money on all sorts of consuming things. There's all sorts of innovators in Africa that figured out ways to do the same things we're doing in mobile applications, but through SMS, where you don't have to download an app. And so 4 years ago or so, he did this whole talk on you don't need an app for that. And there are actually many scenarios where an app is not required, and I think today the rest of the world is just kind of realizing, yeah, I mean, downloads from the iTunes Store and Android, they're going down. Less people are downloading because, I mean, I'm going to project my phone on the screen here in a few minutes. I'll quickly show you how many apps I have, and I can tell you I probably use 3 of them. Most of the apps that I download, I may never even open, or if I open them once, that's a win, right? So we're all in touch with how those things are trending, I think, in all of our own ways. So this is what we're gonna try and cover in this short window. Let's talk about the anatomy of great bot experiences. Because if the hard part is no longer creating bots, if technology is becoming easier for people like me that don't know how to code, to just make my own bot. If that's no longer the hard part, then the hard part becomes making sure that whatever you create is a good experience, right? You can make a building, doesn't mean it's a good building. It could just be a block with nothing in it. It offers no experience and no intuitive elements that help you understand how to navigate it. And we're gonna review an existing bot. And then the part that I think is gonna be really cool, and this is, the part 2 of this is whatever you do on your own after this, if you want to. But we're actually gonna take the existing bot that we review, and if you want to, and you have a laptop, or you wanna share with someone, or even if it's after this, when you get home, we're gonna make that existing bot yours. So you're gonna be able to customize it. And I'm gonna teach you how to code it. No, that's not true at all. That's the awesome part, that's no longer required. I couldn't teach you anyway, because I don't know how. So, can somebody explain what a bot is? I mean, we've kind of talked about it a few times, but I'd love to know just how it's sitting in people's brains. Is there anybody that's willing to just, yeah? Automatic response to a message. That is at least the beginning of it. Yeah, so any bot will start with some sort of automated response. Either it's engaging you, or you are engaging it, and it knows what to do with it, when you engage it, or it's engaging you because it was designed to engage you in a certain way. Engaging you might be, next year you might get a text from the conference saying, hey, just a reminder, conference starts tomorrow, right? if the bot can respond if you ask it a question, that's a whole other story, right? So that's where what you said is just the beginning of it.
It seems like almost a personal concierge or personal assistant.
That's a fantastic way to describe it. Yeah, personal concierge or assistant. Yeah, but a robot.
Your web or yeah. Bot personal assistant.
Yeah. Has anyone used a bot? Yeah. Great, yeah.
I do all the time. My credit card, every time I have a transaction, it'll text me saying you purchased this.
Oh, nice, okay. Credit card text.
Every time my agent is due, it'll give me
H&R Block?
Yeah,
is this one?
Card.
Okay, yeah.
And it'll send you a message if you use your card.
Yeah.
It'll give you your balance. It'll tell you what your transaction was.
Yeah, that's a great example, H&R Block. Yeah, I don't know about others. I know that Verizon does this as well, but I'm an AT&T customer. I get texts saying, hey, your bill's ready. The part that I liked that changed a couple years ago was that it stopped being just, hey, your bill's ready, and it started offering reply one to pay it now, reply two for other payment options. So I can reply one, and it says, do you want to use card ending in whatever number? I say yes, and my payment's done.
PCS Mobile, or Mobile PCS.
Yeah.
They vote on T-Mobile.
Yeah, so.
And they do the same thing, and they've got an app that you can go in, and it's
exactly, yeah. So that's where we start to realize a lot more hands go up, because those are bots, right? A lot of us have used those. Anyone in the room have a bot for their city or county, not counting Luke? No? Yeah, Chicago does, we know that. Yeah?
I'm going to say, on the negative side of the bot, we've been experiencing a situation with our O'Hare Midway voice complaints that there's an organization that's using a bot to put in noise complaints. It has quadrupled the noise complaints for the airports. So when you're looking at traffic and how much volume is coming in, it went from the year before 2014 of approximately 435,000 to over 4 million. And they're using the bots to do it. So
we are
looking at putting a capture on the website to avoid that because it is not clearly representing legitimate complaints.
Yeah, so that's a really solid concern. Same thing with websites. So as you mentioned, you're going to put a capture on it. You can put a capture in the bot also. Please authenticate yourself. And unless a bot is designed to be intelligent enough to bypass that, the same way they would have to be intelligent enough to bypass that on the website, it's not gonna overcome it on your bot either. So yeah, there is a lot of thinking that a lot of that has to do with what is a good experience, right? A good experience for your organization as well. So this is a quote actually from your, I think maybe former CIO, but and this has come up a couple times. So the city of Chicago, top 14 reasons that people call 911 make up 70% of the city's call volume, right? So Chicago is already on it. They realize that means there's gonna be at least some opportunities for automation and automation on multiple channels, whether it's web, whether it's an SMS bot. These are where your opportunities lie. So we're gonna get into an example like this. But this is, again, we looked at it for a moment yesterday, and this will be quick. But this is a video that DC put together of what their bot does. And we're actually going to look at a bot that will become your bot, whether you use it or not, that does something fairly similar, where you're texting in some of the like top hit, and I made some assumptions just to put together a template bot for you, but some of the top hit items that might come into your 3-1-1 call center are part of this automated bot experience, right? So this is a living example. So paying parking meters, reporting a pothole, getting government agency information, etc. So before we jump into that, let's first look at the anatomy of a good bot experience. I'll talk through each of these pieces. So identification, this is a good bot experience should, in some fashion, even if it's very lightweight, it should be able to understand who it's talking with. And that might be on the level of knowing that it's Luke that texts in, because Luke has texted in before and gave his name last time. So now The next time Luke texts in, it says, hi Luke, how can I help you this time? Right? It might be being able to identify this is not a spam bot that's consuming my resources. Right? So it asks you to verify that you're not a robot. Right? Identification of some kind where we, the same way that just as humans we can see this is one of my colleagues or whatever it is. Identity, slightly different. This is the bot's version of knowing and understanding itself, right? Which is a weird concept for technology, but it's the idea that it the experience you designed for your bot knows its place, which kind of sounds mean, but it's not a human, it's a bot. It needs to embody the idea that it doesn't know everything, right? It needs to embody the idea that it's serving you in the best way that it can. It needs to know when it doesn't know something. We'll talk more about that. Trainability and learning. This is something that, for those that are interested, I'm happy to follow up and equip you with examples or even your own version of this. But great bot experiences should have an element where you can teach it more. So so let's say Nick has a bot in Denver. If Nick happens to be the administrator of it, if we go back to identification, the bot should know when Nick authenticates itself that its master is texting it. And therefore, Nick might say teach as a keyword. That might be designed as part of the experience. The bot might automatically respond because it knows it's Nick. Okay, what do you want to teach me? Nick replies, parking meters. Okay, parking meters. What do you want me to do when someone says parking meters? And he starts teaching it. It'll now own that experience for anybody else that's texting it. If he, as the administrator,
master.
Something about those terms really, like, yeah. So tactical and complex tasks. I won't get too deep into this, but this came up with Luke and in another session earlier. Tactical and complex tasks would be something like, two scenarios. Scenario one, you text in, you want help with a parking ticket. It says, okay, parking tickets, and sends you a link to more information or where you can pay for parking tickets. Scenario two, same thing, you text in parking tickets. Okay, would you like to A, pay this parking ticket? B, get more information about this parking ticket? Say you choose A, pay it. It says, okay, great, complete your payment profile here. You click the link, complete your payment profile, complete your payment, and then it starts texting you again, knowing that you've completed it, right? So it, now it's starting to actually, it's the difference between a bot that can give you information and a bot that can do stuff. Like, it's getting stuff done for you. Elegantly non-knowing. This is a bot that, a good bot should have humility. So the way that I describe it, it's actually a really easy concept to get. The way that I describe it is, think you're in a restaurant. Okay, so say I'm the waiter and Luke is one of my patrons, okay? And I'm walking by serving somebody else and Luke says, excuse me, do you have caviar? Because Luke loves caviar. And one scenario, I totally ignore him. I don't even look at him, okay? The other scenario, I walk by, excuse me, do you have caviar? And I say, oh, I'm sorry, we don't have caviar, but can I show you a menu of things that you might also like? Right? In one scenario, if we translate this to a bot should be able to say, I'm sorry, I don't know how to help you with that, but here are some other things that I can help you with, versus no response or error, like things. Or for those that have been in technology for a while, that kind of thing, like the no response or the you don't understand response, is the equivalent to like Java run script error. Right. When you're like what? I don't know. Yeah. And reportability, it's what it sounds like. A good bot should be capturing meaningful information, and hopefully also for the master should be able to deliver information on command to those that are authorized. So the manager of it should be able to text in, show I'm the manager, and ask it questions about its own data. How many people texted me about parking tickets today? Right? The public, maybe, if you enable the bot to, could also ask that same question, but at least a good bot should allow its manager to text in, authenticate itself, and get data about what the bot has been doing. Okay, how much time do we have for the fun part? 15, awesome. This went, I can't believe I was on time.
Nick, you have a different clock than me.
Are you giving up? I'm giving you a little more time because I think this is really cool. I think a lot of people are gonna get a lot out of
perfect.
This.
Perfect, so you let me know what time you need and we'll go from there.
10 after is good.
He paid me, he's buying time because he's trying to finish his presentation over there. So, you don't know it yet, but you own a bot.
Yay!
All of you do. The challenging part is, I don't know, raise your hand if you have a computer in front of you right now. Oh. No? Okay, so all the hands up, the people that have laptops? That's 3, 4. Okay, that's gonna be tough. I think what we might do, for those that have them, let's go ahead and follow along. I'll walk you through what you can do. But for the rest of you, me walking the four of them through what they can do will be your tutorial, and you can know, and we're recording, so you'll have access to this later. You'll also have access to me or people from our support team. I won the battle I wanted and got a commitment to everybody having 30 days with a OneReach account, including support. So, there you go. So, first part, remember the identity? The bot needs to have a sense of itself, and you need to have a sense of it. So it seems like a weird psychological sort of game, but it actually matters a lot for the success of your bot, especially in terms of if and when you gain the confidence that that this is something you want to test amongst your team or even have out in the world, it actually can matter a lot for it to have a name, right? So for example, the DC example, they're about to do a publicity campaign about, it's called DC Bot, right? Like that is the name of it. It's almost gonna have, well, not even almost, it's gonna have its own brand. It will be marketed as DC Bot, the bot that helps you with 3-in-1 stuff. So, think for a quick second. Close your eyes if you need to, I don't know. just think about like what if and when you were to do something like this. Nobody's asking you to do it, but if you were to, ShyBot. Yeah, Chicago's already, they're way ahead. ShyBot. Think about what yours might be, right? Sarasota could be Sarabot. Sounds cute. Okay, so remember, if you don't have a laptop, you don't even have to write this down if you want. I mean, obviously go ahead if you're eager to get to it right after the session. But for those that have laptops and for those that don't, this will be shared later in the deck. The slides will also be shared, so you'll have access. But this is where you will log into your account. You'll use your email address, the same email address that you used for the conference. Your password is just OneReach. No quotes, yeah, thank you, Luke. Lowercase, OneReach. So that's the URL, your username, password. Everybody that's got their laptop open, already there. And also, just a quick important side note, the information the conference gave us to create accounts for this session happened at a certain point in time, and there may have been people that registered after that point. If for some reason you are one of those people, let Luke or myself know. We will make sure that you do get the account that you need. Okay. Okay. So let's see. Just give me one sec here. So here, we're gonna start with looking at an example. So I'm gonna text, this is my phone. I'm gonna apologize in advance if my wife starts texting me. I did tell her I'm in this session, please don't. So I have the contact already in my phone, otherwise that would be just the phone number. With each of the accounts that you have, there's a phone number in that account. It's a real phone number, but it's just for testing purposes. And that will be the phone number that your bot works on until if and when you change it. So I'm just gonna say, hi. The Fortunately, bots work over the most dominant channel in the world. Unfortunately, that channel works over cellular networks. So that means you're beholden to how good your network is at that moment. It's much better than it was when I tested this earlier. This is great. So here's what the bot in all of your accounts already does. Okay? How can I help? I can reply one for building permits, trash collection, parking meters, potholes, six to download our app. So pretty straightforward stuff. Which one should I try? Any votes? Which one? Other parking? All right. Yeah, let's try parking. Well, that was one, right? I had to pick one. Yeah. Somebody said parking. Okay, so, and it's kind of what you'd guess, I'm assuming. Let's see how well that network works now. But yeah, if I recall correctly, it's basically just, I mean, it's the obvious, it's going to show here, you can get more information about parking here, right? As soon as it comes back. But so that's where we were talking about, you can get into complex tasks. You don't have to, but you can go in and edit and change what it does, right? So you can add additional intelligence or legs to that automation so that it doesn't just send you a link to parking information, but there we go. Okay, parking meters, right? So and then it sends a link, and this is Evanston's information. So those that have their laptops, is anybody logged in?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's show you what that looks like. Okay. So here we're logged in. It's just a basic OneReach account, so it doesn't have all the bells and whistles, but it's enough for this simple kind of bot here. And I can go and manage contacts, I can create solutions for inbound or outbound SMS or voice, and you can add other channels like Facebook and Slack and Amazon and Echo, like we were talking about. But in this example, we're gonna look at inbound. In your accounts, your bot is not active yet. This one's already active, as you can see, I was just using it. So when everybody logs in, and again, myself and others on our team can help you with this. You don't have to remember it all now. You can just say help, and we can shoot you an email or get on the phone. But you'll go into your account, you'll activate one that's a bot that's inactive. So you go to inbound, inactive. But in my example, so those that are logged in right now, go to inactive, and you'll see there's a bot there. In this example, I'm opening my bot that's already active, and what you'll start to see is the way I like to describe it to people. So it looks like a map, basically, showing where you go. The way I like to describe it to people is, if we weren't all here doing this with each other right now, and instead I was sitting talking with one of you, we were sitting in a coffee shop somewhere, and I said, okay, well, you know, what do you think New Orleans bot should do? And I just gave you a piece of paper and said, drive, right? And you started mapping out, well, when somebody texts in, it should respond this way and ask them to choose one of these options. And then depending on what response they choose from those options, it should go down one of these paths. That's how this application works. So people that don't have a code, like me, can just draw what they want and then activate it. And that's what you do. You draw what you want and activate it. You can duplicate it and make changes to it so that you can keep your bot live while you make it smarter and then activate the new version. Or you can deactivate it, make changes to it and reactivate it. So let's get into the weeds so you can connect the dots between what we tried over my phone a moment ago and what's on the screen, even though, oh wow, it's a little small. So I'll just point it out in case it's not obvious. So here, remember when I first texted in, hi? This is that initial response. Hi, how can I help you? Choose one of these. right? Then we can see these are the legs for each of those options. So when I created this, I dragged things on to draw it. Said, do this here, do that here, do that here. The fun part for you guys is this, once you've activated it in your account, it's live, and it'll do the same thing as what I just tried, right, on my phone. But you can change it to be whatever you want. So if we go back, I think I lost, my cell phone's not connected anymore. Oh, there it is. So for example, that link takes me to City of Evanston's parking information. You would, if you want to test it, you would just edit that particular part of it, you just put in your link. Or if you want to really go for it and make it capable of complex tasks, we can help you even show you, we can even help you to set it up so that it's connected to payments, so somebody can pay it through text, get a link to create a payment profile, complete the payment, then continue with, it's basically an IVR, it's textable, or an ITR, that's what they were called until the bot became cool. So let's go back to the tool here. I'm going to duplicate the experience of the same bot we were just using. And I'm going to change. So here, what a bummer that we can't see it that well. Oh well, that's my fault for not testing it earlier. But so here, this particular path, it's, what's that? Yeah, so in this example, this is the path that it goes down if somebody responds 6 for get a link to download my app, right? The interesting thing about that one, a common use of that is, you might even offer that in your IVR. So that's where like bots can start talking with the stuff that you already have. So you might have an IVR and add a new leg to it that says, press 2 if you want to receive a text with a link to download our app, or a link to our mobile website. And now, you don't even have to change your IVR or your phone system, you can just tack this onto it. So now, someone pressing that option triggers a text to the same number that person just called from. Or you can ask them, are you on a mobile or a landline? And then depending on which way it goes. So I don't want to complicate things too much here, but in this example, this is a link to 311 Evanston's app, right? So if I'm New Orleans and I've got a mobile web, a responsive site that maybe Verint is supporting for us, I can go ahead and change that link to whatever that link is, right? If I want to get even more into it, so let's zoom out here. Say for example, so again, here's the main menu, and all of this is editable. Remember, it's just a map where you can make it do whatever you want it to, right? So say I want to change one of the 6 options or just add a new one. All I'm gonna do is just click this. Now I've got a new leg, right? So I might say this is, yeah. Yeah, you do.
To do it ourselves.
That's why we wanted this to be in the world, is so that you didn't have to be a developer to do it. So it's meant for anybody to use. And depending on how technical you are, it takes more or less training. Some people, like one of the guys in DC was amazing. He like taught us things about our tool that we didn't even know it could do. So some people just jump right in and they're like off to the races, like connecting it to their own data on the back end. Like we didn't even know they had an account. They signed up on their own. But you may be the opposite end of that spectrum, need a quick tutorial. Or, yeah. Another quick question? I think we've got to wrap it up here.
Is there a testing environment? So people are so secure, if you want to try it, but don't want it necessarily
Yeah, so that's the kind of trick that we did for you. Is you've got this account, you've got a phone number in it. You could do all of this over your existing local landline or through in one number or a short code, but you have a number in here that's not one of those. And it is a live phone number, but nobody knows it. And definitely nobody knows that it's your phone number. So that means, yeah, that's how you test this. So that means you can go home, there might be a few other people on your team, like, hey, look what I can do, you just show them. I'm in bot, look at how smart I am. But don't tell anyone about the phone number other than the team you're testing it with.
And how do you get pricing? You talk about searching and travel.
Oh, yeah. So all the basic, like, off-the-shelf pricing is on our website. For anybody that needs any sort of custom configurations or needs certain service level agreements or guaranteed uptime or anything like that, then it takes a custom license, but yeah. So I think we gotta wrap up. Is that useful? I mean, not everybody had their laptop, but, yeah.
Where do you find your number?
So it's in your account, so you can see when I'm logged into my bot here. The number that the bot operates on is right here.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, but there's gonna be a lot of, you guys are gonna have a lot of questions. No question is a silly question. Remember, I have all kinds of, frankly, stupid questions for my support team. You can do that too. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much to Elias and OneReach for helping make this possible. I think you could make an argument. I'm not sure that there's been a government conference yet where the attendees have been able to build a bot, so that's pretty cool stuff. And please reach out to myself or Elias or his team if we can help you further in that. So thank you for going through that with us, and hopefully it was beneficial to you. The one thing I just want to stress is, like, the cool thing is it's really actually not rocket science, as you kind of saw a glimpse of. You don't have to be a coder or a developer to do this, and it also doesn't cost a gazillion dollars either, and I think our residents and citizens will really like it, so thank you so much.